Hi, welcome to our video, right on cue. Starts in quickly, doesn't it? Reach a certain date, boom! Happens fast. We're talking about the Blood Moon Tetrad that's coming up, the four consecutive full lunar eclipses with a full solar eclipse in between those. The first full Blood Moon, the Blood Moon is April 15th of this year, then we shift over to October 8th of this year, then we have a total solar eclipse on March 20th of 2015, then April 8th, another full lunar eclipse, and then September 28th, we have another full lunar eclipse, a blood moon. So we have four consecutive total lunar eclipses, blood moons, where the dust of the atmosphere and the angle of the sun and the eclipse makes the moon appear reddish, which is why I'm wearing red here. And then in the middle, the solar eclipse. And so it's a very rare occurrence to have these four blood moons in a row with a solar eclipse, full solar eclipse right in the middle of them. Some are saying that that hasn't happened in the last 2,000 years. Therefore, this could be the sign that was written in the Bible. When the sun refused to shed its light and the moon turns blood like blood. Well, you have the total solar eclipse in the middle of this four blood moons. It's pretty compelling if you add everything else that's going along too. So if you look at the total picture, you know, you got to say, hey, this could be it. This could be what we have been told to prepare for. And just as I turn this video on, this sound of this, you know, this, it's a blower. Maybe the winds of change will suddenly start blowing right away. I was in my truck yesterday, and suddenly the whole truck started reverberating. I said, oh my God, what's going on? It just freaked me out. And then I figured, you know, it must be like those deep bass speakers in some cars that just, but I couldn't figure out where it's coming from. The car in front of me, the little car in back of me. And I said, maybe I thought my car truck was blowing up. You know, it was just the whole thing was shaking and reverberating. And so I turned the engine off. I was waiting at a stoplight. And it didn't stop. So I said, no, okay, it's got to be the car behind me. I'm telling you, never experienced anything like it. The entire atmosphere was reverberating like that. It is terrifying. I was very unnerved and frightened by it. I thought my truck was like falling apart. But it was this deep subwoofers that this little car must have had in it. Incredibly powerful. That inside the truck with all the windows closed, the whole atmosphere is reverberating. So these things are very interesting when they happen. The timing of events, you have to understand. The Holy Spirit has a sense of humor in how it shows us things. And the most trivial thing, the timing of it, we can say, wow, very interesting. So some Christians who follow prophecy believe that this is the time of the return of Christ within the next year. Could be year and a half. These blood moons happen over a period of about a year and a half. April, May, June, July, August, September, yeah, October. Year and a half period. So the belief is that this historical, quote unquote, return of Christ, time of the return of Christ, is now upon us. And from what I've gotten from the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit saying it, very soon, we're going to be right there. So it's probably quite soon. But of course, what does that mean? Return of Christ, what does that mean? I don't know exactly. It's very interesting. The Holy Spirit does not tell us ahead of time very often about certain things. Why? It was explained to me today why. Usually it waits till the last second and then says, this is the answer here. And then you say, oh, of course, now I see it. Because prior to that, we're procrastinating and we're placing our faith in other options that don't work. And we have so much faith in those options, so much investment, that if the Holy Spirit were to tell us ahead of time what the real answer is, we would say, you know, maybe, but these other ones seem more likely or something. And so actually what happens is these other options we're considering, actually they're super dangerous, they don't work, they're terrible. But we don't see that. We don't see it. So, but we feel some fear. We don't know where the fear is coming from. Now, if the Holy Spirit told us what the answer was, we would still be loyal to our options, but we'd feel the fear. So what do? We project it over onto the Holy Spirit's answer, and we think that it's fearful. Suddenly we think, oh yeah, the fear's coming from there. It must not be coming from my options. It's coming from the Holy Spirit's option. So what the Holy Spirit has to do first is have us examine our options and see that they're not right, that they're flawed, that they're wrong. And only when we open up to that and say, okay, I'm mistaken, I'm wrong, only then is it safe for the Holy Spirit to say, okay, and here is what really works. And then we say, oh, of course, of course, of course, I see that. And you don't transfer, project fear onto it. So that's how I see it. That's how I see the way, how come we don't know exactly what's going to happen? We haven't been told exactly what's going to happen. Based on another very unique experience today, someone relating to me a situation that they had, an amazing situation. It clicked in, we need to be living in quote-unquote gated communities. But what that gate implies and where this community will be, I don't know. But it's a basic principle, is going to be very much a Wild Wild West marauding type of situation in the world coming up. And you need to be in an enclave. You need to be gated. You need to be protected from this, what's going to happen in the world. Now, just yesterday, I believe it was yesterday, the day before yesterday, the Holy Spirit opened my eyes to my mind, opened my mind to realizing that all of this projection is just a prank that we're playing on ourselves. And this is a superior explanation to everything else. It's superior. I've been testing it out. And it removes the fear out of the whole situation and turns it to laughter, to humor, actually. And having seen this and realizing that we're just playing a prank on ourselves, it really opens up the door to a clear explanation of what the remedy is. And what I did a video saying that we need to prank the prank, or that God needs to prank the prank, prank our prank. Because juveniles, when they're trying to see how badly they can scare themselves, they do funny things, knocking themselves out, holding their breath, scaring themselves, all sorts of funny things, right? They relate very well to that level. And so when you say, okay, if they're doing a prank, and you say, well, you need to stop. You can't, parent just can't come in and say, okay, you got to stop that. They're going to say, no way, I'm into this. So what you need to do as a parent, you need to play a prank on the prank. And then when you do that, they'll say, oh, that's really cool. I like your humor. I like the way you did that. You're okay with me. This is great. You pranked my prank. And they laugh and laugh and laugh, and all is fine. All is well. So this is what God has done. God created the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit has pranked our prank. And the Holy Spirit showed me this morning, the answer. And it's so amazing. It's so amazing. But most importantly, my spirit likes it. My spirit likes this answer. It's just, wow, God's really cool. Has a sense of humor. God pranked my prank, you know. I said, oh, yeah, I like it. So the decision is at the level of spirit. Okay, it's spirit that decides, not our intellect, thoughts, not words, concepts, thoughts. It's really at the level of spirit. It's spirit is the one that's pranking itself. So it has to accept the prank on its prank in order to have it resolved. It's not going to just go for these dry explanations, you know. Spirit's just kind of going, it doesn't really relate to me. You know, I try to explain to a teenager, right? Logically, rationally, reasonably, you need to do this and this. I just say, I'm pretending I'm invisible. I'm scaring myself. Oh, I'm so scared. Parents say, what's wrong with you? Oh, I'm so scared. Monsters are after me. The whole thing, you know. They say, what are you talking about? And so the parents have to do something, you know, that gets the adolescent can say, oh, you know what, that's really cool, I like that, and say, okay, I was just joking, you know, joke the joke, in other words, joke the joke, this is all a joke, okay, we're joking ourselves, we're pranking ourselves, we're trying to say, God, I found something superior to reality, it's called death, you know, we're making it up, it's a joke, we're playing on ourselves. So, the Holy Spirit jokes the joke. And I was shown this morning what it is. I hope you can hear me over this. I'll get closer over this leaf blower. How to explain this? It certainly requires a deep sort of acceptance and a feeling of trust in the Holy Spirit to get this. Otherwise, this is not going to happen. But I had enough trust and enough familiarity with the Holy Spirit that I was able to listen. And I just said, oh, that's cool. That's very cool. I really like that. It has to do with time. And the prank we're playing is a prank with time. Play on ourselves. We're just having a lark, kind of a crazy adolescent lark. We're really spirit. We're immortal, supremely immortal, total Son of God, all creative, all powerful, all glory. And we're just having this lark of a crazy time prank, joking ourselves with death, with impermanence, with form, with appearance. So, how to explain what the Holy Spirit does? The Holy Spirit really has a joke, has a way to joke the joke, for sure. And somehow getting in the right state of mind that I was in through all the spiritual practices I've done. I was able to see it and appreciate it. I said, I like that. I love that. That's fabulous. Call it the justice of God. The final judgment, actually. The final judgment. The justice of God. That's a way to look at it. And the justice of God is actually... explain this, because people have it backwards. It's the coolest justice imaginable. It's totally great. And the justice is that we see everything instead of a localized perspective. It's a totally non-localized perspective, that everything has the same non-localized perspective, that all is eternal life. All is totally non-localized, non-spatialized, eternal life. And all at the same time, everything has exactly the same perspective. All at once, all at exactly the same time. Total vision of oneness, right? And here's the joke, is that can happen right now. We don't need time for everything to see everything at the same time. And since we've made this billions and billions of years, this is like, you know, almost infinite time, to realize the Holy Spirit can show us the end of time right now is very cool. very cool. It makes you laugh. It's amazing. Your spirit likes this, because it's so completely audacious, you know, like, oh, I thought I had, you know, we had to wait. We have to wait forever for everything to get on the same page. We have to wait forever for everything to be non-localized. Of course, how can everything be non-localized, actually? See, it's a miracle. It's a miracle where we thought we're gonna, the joke is that we are trapped in time, and the Holy Spirit somehow jokes the joke and says, look, you're not trapped in time. Everything's, all timing is all suddenly, all at once, everything has the exact same perspective. You call it the enlightened perspective of saying this is non-localized. My perspective is not coming from sensory perception or the conscious, localized consciousness. It's realizing that there's only pure spaciousness, only eternal life. And this realization is everywhere. Everything that I thought was separate is having the exact same non-localized realization. Now, everything eventually in time will reach this realization. Everything will reach, but all consciousness will reach this realization. But it could take unlimited time, actually, the way that we've set it up, this joke on ourselves. But at the end point, everything will have this non-localized awareness that there's only eternal life, and everything is having this realization all at the same time, but everything eventually reaches. It's like little bubbles going up to the surface, little bubbles. Every single, like carbonation, all right? You're watching carbonation in a bottle, and you see all these bubbles streaming up to the surface. Well, eventually all the bubbles will stream to the surface and will be completely flat, right? But that takes a lot of time. Some bubbles go quickly, some go slowly, et cetera, like that, right? But what the Holy Spirit does is it shows us the end point where all the bubbles have gone to the surface. And the whole thing is flat, it's all smooth now. So it shows us the end point of time, but it shows us that end point right now. We don't have to wait for the end point of time. Because the end point of time is exactly the same as the beginning point of time. Okay. The Alpha, the Omega. Eternal life is exactly the same before we dreamed of time and after we stopped the dream of time. It's exactly the same. So what I saw is we can, within time, as we're in time, we can see the end of time. And we can see everything, every person, every place, everything, every situation, everything is aware that eternal life is non-localized, totally non-localized. It's not dependent on any appearance at all. And it's a one shared realization. It's the one shared realization of everything. And that no more need for time, you see. And we can have that realization right now. Right now. So in explaining this, it doesn't quite capture it. It doesn't quite capture it. But I was able to see it. I was able to see what the Holy Spirit is offering. And I said, wow, I love it. And this is called the justice of God. It's called the final judgment. This is the final judgment. The final judgment is the realization in time of everything having no judgment as far as localization goes. I am this, I'm here, you're over there, I am this, you are that, etc. No, it's a collective, total, unified realization that we're all it. Right now. So time is not like I'm going to be it in a little while. When everything reaches the end point of realizing we're all it. See, but that, we don't need to wait for it, because the Holy Spirit has the end point for us. It's joking our joke. It knows how to joke our joke of time. Time is a joke. We're playing on ourselves. And the Holy Spirit says, well, I'll trump this one. I'll bring the end of time into time, you see. And almost only God could do that. So it reminds us of our Father, of our Creator. I say, oh, that's got to come from God. Got to. And I realize that God's not angry at us. He's not upset or anything. He's joking us. He says, oh, okay, you want time? I'll give you time. I'll give you the end of time right now. And then I realize I don't have to wait. Nobody has to wait. If you can accept this joke of the joke, you don't have to wait at all. You can accept it right now. You can accept the justice of God right now. That is the justice of God. Everything seeing unified, all seeing at the same moment that there's only eternal life. And there's no identity based on location, locality, or appearance, or form, or anything. Everything seeing that together. It's not me seeing it and you're still not seeing it. It's everyone seeing it together. That point is reached in time, actually. Theoretically, it's reached, but we don't need to wait for it, because the Holy Spirit has it for us right now, that end point of time. Because it shows us how's that going to feel. Well, we can know how it feels right now. Because if everyone is going to get there at some point, that point is going to be reached, right? It's going to be reached. And it's going to be exactly the same right now as it will be at any point in time. Because the end point, the quality of the end point is going to be exactly the same. So the Holy Spirit already knows how our joke ends. So it brings the end punchline of the joke to us right now. It tells us, here is the punchline right now. And we say, wow, I don't have to wait for trillions and trillions of years. Now, our spirit loves this. Our spirit loves this. It's just sheer. Only God would have come up with that. That's the final judgment. The final judgment is complete absence of judgment from everything, not just from you, from everything, simultaneously. This is just broaching this topic because it doesn't quite, mentally, we can't grasp it very easily at all. You have to somehow, you have to see it. And it just came to me. I said, I accept the justice of God, the justice of God. I began practicing this and it just suddenly, I became aware of what it is. And then I was aware of my spirit saying, yes, I love, this is it, this is it. And I can understand now how Jesus said that he was the first one to fully accept God's plan of salvation. And I was always kind of saying, huh, why is he saying that? You know, why is that? And I realized that this is a different plan than most people are following. You know, I've never heard of this before. I've really never heard of this, that the Holy Spirit, what it can do for us, it can show us the end of time. Right now, everything, totally realizing, at the same moment, there's a total collective, oh, okay, we all know it was only a joke. We all get the joke. Here's a better way to put it. Let's say somebody tells a joke to an audience, and the joke goes over the head of the audience most, and they're all saying, I don't quite get that. I don't quite get it. And I don't get the punchline. And so everyone in the audience is kind of thinking about it, sitting there thinking about it. And then one person starts chuckling and says, I get it. And people say, wow, they got it, huh? I don't get it yet. Then another one, then after a while another one. And so it goes on and on. This audience, you know, over years and years, finally a billion years, 10 billion, trillion years, and there's still a few members of the audience that don't quite get it. And the rest of the audience is just waiting there for them to get it, because they say, we can't have a collective laugh until everybody gets it, because we need a collective laugh. We need everybody to laugh together. And when we laugh together, the punchline, actually. That is the punchline. All laughing together. But we're waiting trillions of years, right? So what the Holy Spirit does is it shows us like this video. A trillion years in the future where everyone has gotten the joke, the punchline, and everyone is laughing together. There's a total collective laugh. And the Holy Spirit is showing us this movie right now of our future collective laugh, when once everyone gets it. Because the Holy Spirit knows everybody is going to get it at some point, and it knows that point. Okay, this is a better way to explain it. I'm just trying to explain it here, find a way to explain it to you. I like this explanation here. A great comedian tells this unbelievable joke, and it's such a great joke that nobody can quite get it yet. And then gradually, bit by bit, they get it. But the actual punchline of the joke, where we really get it, is when everyone gets it together. They could all laugh together. And the collective laughter of everything together, that is the end of the joke. You get it. Now you get it. The joke is over. Joke on us, or playing a joke on ourselves. So the joke ends when everyone collectively gets the joke, right? You say, oh, we were just playing a joke on ourselves. Everyone together gets that. But when is that going to happen? That could be go on endlessly and what won't happen. So the Holy Spirit shows a movie, as it were, of everything getting the joke. Realizing, oh, we were only joking ourselves. Everyone, everything, it's brought into this moment right now. It's brought to us this moment right now. And then that frees us from the joke. We set down the prank. We don't need it anymore. We've had our laugh. We've had our laugh. We've had our good laugh. Ah, I see. We were only joking. And it's a collective forgiveness of God, really. Because by having that collective laugh, we realize that everything's okay with God. Totally okay. And all fear of God dissipates entirely. We thought God might have not taken the joke well, right? Like we offended God or something. No, not at all. And by collectively laughing, this collective laughter, we recover our true humor of reality, and it resolves our continuity fear, our fear of God, you know. This is how it works. And once you get a glimpse of it, you'll know, you'll see, I get it. The justice of God is we all laugh together. That is the justice of God. We have to have a final collective laugh. But the Holy Spirit is like taped that final collective laugh in time, already taped it. And then it can show it to us right now. See, that's the joke of the joke. Yes, that's the joke of the joke that we say, oh, that is very clever, Holy Spirit. That is very, very, I like your style. I like that. You know? It doesn't say, yeah, you got to help work, you got to help free them, and you got to teach them, and every one of us has to gradually evolve, and maybe a billion years of evolution, we'll finally be able to get the joke, and, you know. No. We see it right now. We see everything. So when we look at a person, we're not looking at them as somebody who doesn't get the joke. We're seeing them a trillion years in the future, laughing with everyone else. Trillions of years in the future, whatever. All laughing together. And you realize, they did get it. They got it. You know that they got it. And you know this tree got it. And you know this universe got it. And you know every single person got it. They got the joke. They knew that they were just joking. So you know, when you see somebody, you realize that they did get the joke. Because right now we're worried about people, you know. We're worried like, you know, I don't know if they're ever going to get the joke. There are some people like that, right? We all know those who think, wow, I'm really concerned about them. Because I don't think they're ever going to get it. But what the Holy Spirit shows you is they did get it. It may have taken them a long time, but they got it. They got it. So you know that as a fact. So you see this person and say, no, I know as a fact you did get it. It took you several million years, but you did get it. However, when they see this, they can look at the world and realize that everybody in their world did get it also. And so they can, that relieves the burden off of them. So it's this joke of the joke can make time unnecessary for us, actually. It makes time unnecessary for us. Because that person, theoretically, took a million years, they finally got it. But once they realize that you too got it, and everyone else got it, and they can see a picture of that, of them getting it in time, they can say, well, what do I need time for? I don't need time then. Let's finish, we're done with it. We're done with it. It's a miracle. It makes time unnecessary. It makes time unnecessary, and we love it because of the way the Holy Spirit does it. It's so funny. It's so artful, so genius, you know, joking the joke, pranking the prank. So without this, you see, we're seeing everything without the miracle of the Holy Spirit. So without that, it's going to take this person millions of years. Okay, fine. But the Holy Spirit doesn't interfere with that. He says, okay, here's this person in a million years. This is what they're going to be like. And you see them laughing. They get it. But then you realize, oh, wait a minute. Well, then if that's the case, why do we even need that time, the million years? Since we already know how it turns out, we don't need it, right? What if we were watching a movie, and the movie goes on for millions of years, and we're waiting for the end of the movie, you know? It's like, gosh, I just got to see the end, how this turns out. But what if someone comes in and says, shows you the end of the movie right now and says, this is how it turns out? Then you say, oh, I don't need to watch all the rest of this movie. I already know how it ends. So I'm not going to spend another trillion years watching this movie. I already know how it ends, and I love the ending, and the ending's all I need. That's all I need. I don't need the rest of this stuff. I only need to see how it ends. It's just like saying, I only need to realize that I was just playing a joke on myself. That's it. And once I know that, don't need it anymore. Don't need to go through all the time. I don't need time. I don't need time to get to the point, because we think that we're learning how to love death. But we can never learn to love death, because there's no value, no meaning, nothing there. It's valueless. So we cannot value the valueless. That's a meaningless endeavor, totally meaningless endeavor. And eventually we'll see that, and then we'll have a good laugh and realize we were only pranking ourselves all along, totally. We just wanted to see how awesome we were. That could we prank ourselves in this way? Could we joke ourselves in this way? That we said, God, I found something more valuable than you. It's like a kid going to their parents and saying, you know what? I found something greater than, you know, greater than you, or more valuable, you know, and I found a better parent than you. Oh, really? Oh, yeah. So we're going to God and says, God, I found something more valuable than reality. Yeah, it's death. Yeah. And we're trying to joke God. We're trying to joke ourselves. We're playing this, you know, trying to be kooky, whimsical, breaking ourselves. And then we realize that's all we've done. That is all we have done. That's all we've tried to do. Once you realize that, you don't need time anymore. You don't need time. Because we're saying, God, you just don't understand that it takes a lot of time for death to gain its value. It's a work in progress, you see. And I haven't quite learned to appreciate it yet and love it yet. But after trillions and trillions of years of watching death, it'll finally dawn on me how much I love death, you see. And that's what we're telling God. It's just a prank. It's a joke. We're saying, oh yeah, God, I just need time to let it mellow. It's like this fine wine. It just has to age for trillions of years. And once it does and matures, then it's going to be better. And God says, yeah, okay, sure. He knows it's a joke. And then send Christ the Holy Spirit to joke the joke for us. And then at some point we realize, oh, God, you know, I guess I don't need trillions of years after all. I think I'm done with the wine. Right now it's done. And don't need the time anymore. Don't need time anymore. So time is what we are using to supposedly allow ourselves to learn how to appreciate death. We think it has no value because we don't know how to appreciate it yet. See? And so we're trying to learn. We say, no, God, we're learning how to appreciate death. We're teaching ourselves how to appreciate death. And God says, okay, sure. Knowing that the Holy Spirit is there with this joke on our joke. So God is actually having a good laugh at the whole thing. because God knows how we wake up. You know, He knows how it's going to happen. And just watching us, you know, enjoying, because He knows that the Holy Spirit's got this joke for us, too. Then we're going to suddenly say, I think I don't need time anymore. Okay. showing us a trillion years or however to the very end and the very end, the endermost, you know, where everybody sort of realizes, hey, you know what? I've just been joking myself. And then poof, joke's over. The joke's over. And again, once we see the other movie right now, we say, oh, I'm not going to watch, wait through all this stuff. Forget it. And once we see, you know, no, that death has no value and it's just a prank we're playing. What do we need time for? Because we only need time because we're saying we're aging, letting death mellow, and we're learning to love it. And once we realize that we can't learn to love it, it's ridiculous. There's nothing to love. Then what do we need time for? I don't need it. We don't need it. So what we do, what the Holy Spirit does, is says, well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring you to the end point of time. And abide in the end point of time. And what you do there, you just have a good laugh. You just, ha, that's great. Oh, I see them. They got it too. They got it. This got it. Everything is getting it together. We all have gotten it. The end point is wonderful. End point of time is wonderful. And then we just abide with that for a little while. Abide in the self. Abide in the end point of time. And abide in the miracle of the Holy Spirit. With no concerns whatsoever. And just totally carefree. Because you've seen how it all ends. And you know, the whole thing was nothing but a joke. A sophomoric silly joke. Nothing ever happened. We never learned to value death, is what we realized. Is we realized, oh, nothing learned how to value death. Hallelujah. See, hallelujah. Did anything learn to appreciate death? No, everything says in the Course Together, no. Hey, did anything at all learn to appreciate to love death? No. Did anything at all ever learn to value death? No. So it's a collective no. Nothing ever learned to value, appreciate, and love death. And then we say, oh, okay. we can set time down now. No problem. So the Holy Spirit shows us how it turns out. No one ever learned how to appreciate death. And so all those people you see right now who are pretending that they're going to learn how to appreciate death, for sure, they're going to. And you're kind of worried about them. You say, oh, maybe this isn't a joke after all. Maybe my joke is turning real. You know how teenagers try to freak themselves out and they say, oh my God, maybe there really are monsters out there. First I thought I was imagining them, now maybe they're real, huh? And there's their friend are there too. And they say, and they look at their friend's going, ah. And they say, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. Maybe they are real. Look at my friend. My friend is totally, really is freaked out. I thought it was just a joke, and now they're freaking out real bad. Ah. And then you start freaking out, and your friend looks at you and says, oh my God, I thought it was a joke, but you're freaking out. Oh my God, it's real. You know, and it's this collective freak out happens. You know how teenagers go to a horror movie or something, and they're all freaking out, and they look at each other, and they're like, oh my God, this is true. Look, everyone's freaking out together. It's like that. So you look at some people and you say, oh my God, they're really learning how to love death. Oh shoot, that scares the heck out of me. Now the Holy Spirit shows them how that in their future, how it ended up for them, and it shows you that they totally realize that no loving, valuing, or appreciating death whatsoever, and they got it, it's all just a joke, and they're laughing, laughing, laughing. Ah, big relief for you. So when you see everything that way, all your friends, they all get it was a total joke, then of course you're going to get it too. You're going to realize it too. But if you see all your friends freaking out and taking it real, you think, uh-oh, maybe we made death real. And I don't appreciate it. I haven't learned how to appreciate it yet. I'm in big trouble. I haven't learned how to appreciate it. How am I going to learn how to appreciate it? Now I'm really scared. I'm going to be left behind. No, you realize nobody's left behind. Nobody's left behind. This is the justice of God. This is the justice of God, actually. People are frightened of the justice of God, but when I saw this, I said, oh, I love it. God, bring your justice upon me right now, upon the whole world right now. Bring the final judgment right now. Bring the final judgment right now. I can't wait to see that. Thank God that I see everybody totally hip to the joke. Totally hip to the joke. you know, the hipsters, they like to hang out with them. And that they're around the squares, you know, they say, oh my God, it scares the heck out of the square. The squares are so square, and they don't get the joke, you know. Oh no, you know, teenagers, if they have this inside joke and they're around those that don't get the joke, they don't like it. They don't get the joke. But what if everybody got the joke? How cool would that be? What if you lived in a world where everything got your joke? Everyone knew the same joke, and they all understand it perfectly. How cool would that be? How hip would that be? Where everybody's the ultimate hipsters. That's the situation. We can see that fact right now. We don't have to see people as they imagine themselves to be in time at this moment. We can see them how they actually are when they decide they don't need any time anymore. That they realize that time was all completely unnecessary in the first place. Well, if time is all completely unnecessary in the first place, it means it's unnecessary now, doesn't it? It is completely unnecessary because we're simply spending time entirely idly, trying to learn to love and appreciate and value death, which is just idle, spending time idly, doing nothing. So time is completely unnecessary, always, totally unnecessary. So if that's the case, it must be unnecessary now, right? But it may take a long time for people to realize that time is unnecessary. They weren't doing anything, but it's a fact right now. So there's no reason why you can't give them the benefit of the doubt, right? And the Holy Spirit says, yeah, I know how it ends. I know it, that they too realize the truth. Everyone, everything realized the truth. Eventually, the time was entirely just a joke. It's totally unnecessary. This whole thing about death was a complete joke. That we, the ones that were joking, trying to joke God. Not God. God was not trying to joke us. God didn't come to us one day and say, you know what, son of God, spirit of truth, I actually have another creation that's even greater than you, and I'm going to give you the opportunity to learn to love that creation. Is the creation of death. And, oh, really? Yeah, but it's going to take you a long time, billions and billions, trillions of years before you finally learn how to appreciate death. But when you do, oh gosh, it's going to be even better than the reality. And you say, oh, okay, God, whatever you say. That didn't happen. That never happened. Okay, it never happened. We're believing that to make the joke seem more scary to us. We think, well, I can't really learn how to appreciate and love and appreciate and value death. But if I imagine that God wants me to and has told me I have to do this, then maybe I'll work a lot harder at it. So we prank ourselves, we joke ourselves this way too. We keep adding on, you know, flavor to the joke, saying, oh yeah, this is God is telling me I have to do this. That never happened. That never happened. We're just making that up to try and embellish the joke, make it motivate ourselves to try to learn how to love and appreciate and value that doggone death, because we sure don't like it very much, do we? You know? I woke up this morning and my entire body seemed to suddenly have collapsed. Pain everywhere. Pain in both my hips, pain in my wrists, pain in my hands, pain in my shoulders, pain in my feet. It's like, well, just pain suddenly showed up everywhere in my body. I said, what's this? Never experienced this before. Just like that. Went to sleep. One morning I woke up, my whole body felt painful. I said, uh-oh. uh-oh. Well, what's happening? What's happening is we're trying to put ourselves through an intensive retreat in how to love, appreciate and value death. You know, just like we go on spiritual retreats where we try to calm our minds and nerves and de-stress, etc., and maybe get some insight into something, some non-dual teaching or something. Well, actually, in a bigger scale, we put ourselves through death intensives where we focus really intensely for a certain time frame on how to love, value, and appreciate death, because we're having trouble with that one. And so that's what's going to happen in the world. These four blood moons signify something. Now, apropos of this whole situation, which is going to give you chills, okay, this is going to give you chills when you see this, because you're going to realize that this is what's happening. This is what's up. The opening ceremony in the Sochi Winter Olympics. Okay, I didn't watch any of it. Okay, but I just yesterday came across something, a blurb somewhere on the internet, and then I checked it out. And when I saw it, I said, "Oh my gosh!" Nobody's put this together, as far as I know. It's just, this may be the first time you've heard this, because everybody's saying it's some symbology. Something happened. Yeah, but what is it symbolizing? What happened was, there's five snowflakes that came down. And these five snowflakes were supposed to morph into rings, the Olympic rings, the five Olympic rings. What happened was only four morphed into the Olympic rings. Only four. The fifth one did not. And if you look at a picture of this, the failed Sochi opening ceremony failure, of the Olympic ring failure of the Sochi Olympics, okay, if you Google that and look at a picture of it, what do you see there? You see four full eclipsed full moons, and then you see one sun. That snowflake looks like a sun with the shining rays. The four blood moons with the solar eclipse in that time frame. That's what it's showing you. That's what it's showing the world. And I saw it and I said, "Oh wow!" Now here's something that make even going to give you goosebumps even more. If that's not enough. It's telling us what's to come. This is the time. The four blood moons with the solar eclipse in there. On Russian the Russians who are watching the opening ceremony, what happened was, when this failure, where one of those snowflakes failed to open, they caught that very fast and said, "Uh-oh, there's a malfunction." And they suddenly switched over to Russian television to a rehearsal of the rings opening up, where they all opened up perfectly. And what Russians saw on Russian television was the five rings all opening up perfectly. They didn't see the failed opening. They didn't see the warning. They didn't see it. So someone caught the Russian feed on YouTube, with a video of on YouTube, and shows you what the Russians are showing. They show you how they cut to the snowflake is not opening, the fifth one, and they suddenly cut to now it's opening, and then it all opens perfect. They cut to a rehearsal video of it. How incredible is that? That's got to give you goosebumps. Because what is going on now, after Sochi? The Russians are out of touch with the sentiment of the world in terms of Ukraine going into Crimea, right? And now perhaps getting ready to intervene in Ukraine because of the situation there of people who took over the government buildings, etc. It shows you that Russia is a key player right now in this whole situation. I haven't entirely processed exactly what it means, but I could feel this is super significant, that out of all the world watching the Olympics and realizing, seeing the symbology and say, "Uh-oh, four blood moons, solar eclipse, these are the end times, this is the time to turn of Christ." Russians didn't see that. They're not on the same page. They're not on the same page. And you know that with Putin and the Russians and the way things are going, they're the one country in the world that is not really on the same page. Now, what does that mean? I'm not sure. I'm not judging Russia one way or the other. I haven't quite figured out, you know, what that means. So don't say that don't think that I said something bad about Russia. I did not. I just said they're the one country that is not on the same page. They're on a different page. They're looking at history in a different way, for sure. Now, it could be a positive thing. I don't know. That's why I'm not sure what it means yet. Now, of course, the secrets of Fatima talked about Russia as the key player, and said if Russia doesn't repent and turn away from its direction, they're going to be the ones that cause trouble in the world. Well, certainly, it's possible. The way that the Crimean situation is going on, and Putin's self-aggrandizement of Mr. Macho Man, Superman, the way he presents himself with all these outlandish, incredible things, writing, you know. They show him leading geese on their migration, catching the Bigfoot. I mean, he's got this persona in Russia as some kind of Superman. And the way that is going on there is obviously Russia and the rest of the world are not on the same page. And so this has been shown prophetically in the Sochi opening ceremony, showing us that the screw up is coming. The screw up is coming. And these are the times. We're in the times. Very fortunately for us, we now have this uber perspective on time that the Holy Spirit's been able to show me and been able to accept it. And now I know for you, I love it. I can tell you for 100% certainty, every single one of you, your spirit, once you see this, you're going to love it. You're going to say, that's the coolest thing ever. It is the absolutely coolest thing ever. It totally trumps all other cool. Entirely. Entirely. And my spirit just said, I love it. It wasn't an intellectual thing. It was a spiritual thing. I said, God, that is so totally cool. I love your sense of humor. I love how you dealt with that situation. That's my creator. I love it. And it reinsures us that our creator is totally cool. He joked our joke. Got the joke. And took it the right way. Took it in good humor, you know? What do kids want? They want their parents to take stuff in good humor, right? The kids are going to screw up, right? But the parents can look at it in the big picture and laugh and laugh with them. They say, oh, you know what? I got a really cool parents. And once the kids realize their parents are really cool in a responsible way, then, you know, they say, hey, you know what? I don't think I'm going to be an idiot anymore. I think I see some better role model than being just an idiot. But I wanted to test my parent out. So what Spirit did is it just tested God out. It said, you know what? I just want to test God out. Just test God. And so we've tested God now. And God has responded in a way that we absolutely love. And we say, you know what? I'm no longer going to be an idiot. I'm no longer going to joke myself. Now I can trust God. I can trust God. I can trust my Father, you know? That's how I felt. I can trust God. Wonderful. God, bring on your justice right now. Bring on the final judgment. I love it. So, this is a huge breakthrough. Huge breakthrough. That this has been able to be seen and accepted here in this world. In this world. Now, Jesus was telling us about this, but he was channeling it through, you know, Helen Schuckman, and then Bob Tedford helped out. I think William Tedford? I can't remember. Well, Tedford, I think that's his name. In A Course in Miracles, pointing this out, and we needed all this time to get it. I mean, I've been studying nonstop since, you know, summer of 1978. It took all that time to April 9th. To get it. I've been working nonstop for all that time, like in a total emergency mode. Like there's the greatest emergency ever coming, and I have to get it in time. So it's pretty cool that Jesus put that back, the Course in Miracles back at that time, knowing that we needed the time, knowing what's coming up, that we had to get it before these blood moons occurred, before the first of these blood moons occurred. Because the blood moons are going to bring pain. You know, there's something going on here that we're taking an intensive retreat now. Very interesting again that Michael Schumacher, who had this sudden, you know, flipped out, hit his head. Most people thought he's not going to recover. He may be recovering now, actually. He's having moments of consciousness, and I believe some maybe recognition or words or something. He's starting to wake up. So this intensive that we may have, how many, when will that happen? Late December, January, February, March. So it's closing in on like 4 months. 4 months, four blood moons. It may be, what, 4 years of hell on this planet, or I don't know, 4 decades, 4 years maybe, and then it'll kind of cool down or something. Very interesting stuff happening right now. But we have this perspective grounded here. It's not just being channeled. I actually saw it. I see it. I appreciate it. I understand it. I understand it and I accept it. I got the understanding of it and the acceptance. I said, oh, okay, now I understand it. I understand it. Only took me all these years. Was it 78 till now? I don't know. Who can have this? 36, 37 years or something. Well, it took me that long. Because you can't appreciate it intellectually. The appreciation is spiritual. Because the intellect is not in charge, it's the spirit. Spirit's in charge of the joke. And spirit has to decide, okay, I'll accept this resolution to it. I accept this. I accept it. So I do, I accept it. I accept the final judgment right now. That everyone has got the joke. Everyone gets the, everyone's gonna get the joke. Everything's gonna get the joke. That is a truism right now. And if it's a truism in time, it's a truism right now, isn't it? If it's a certainty, it means it's a certainty right now, right? Yeah, if it's a certainty it's gonna happen, you can appreciate it that it's gonna happen right now. You can know it. It's known. It's a known fact. It's a known fact. Then you go, ah, truth is true right now. Oh, yeah. And you get it. Truth is true right now. So 1 minute, 1 second, I want to put on pause. All right. So this is a very good situation, finally. I know that I've seen. I've seen it. I've seen the remedy here. So this provides some sense of assurance that somehow it'll percolate throughout the world. It'll somehow percolate. And people can sigh, you know, a sigh of relief, because as we're going into this intensive, we're nervous that maybe somebody that go in this intensive is going to figure out how to love, appreciate, and value death, and that means all the rest of us have to. So we're nervous about it, very nervous about it. And I can reassure you there's no reason to be nervous whatsoever. And we can laugh again. We can keep laughing. And don't need to freak out. Don't need to get nervous. It doesn't matter that they're going into an intensive. It doesn't matter. They're not. It's just still time idly spent. And every single one of them has already in time, got the joke and realized it. They already have. It's a fact right now. It's a fact right now. See, time is horizontal, Holy Spirit's vertical. The Holy Spirit already knows all of time. Already knows all of time. So it's a fact now. It is a fact now. From the Holy Spirit, it's actually factual right now. And the Holy Spirit can tell us that truth is true right now, isn't it? So the truth about how time ends, that we all realize we never needed time, that's a truth right now. Because it's a true right now that we never needed it. If we never needed it, that's a fact right now, isn't it? So we can experience how that fact expresses itself right now. We can experience it right now. That is so totally cool. So this is the most encouraging video I've ever made, for sure. The most encouraging video. So let it sink in, let it sink in, let it sink. And what happens next? Oh my gosh, I don't know. But we're certainly going to find out. Okay. Thanks for watching, and thanks to everybody who watches the videos, who comments on the videos, who likes the videos, who, all of this stuff is super helpful, actually, because I do read all the comments, and I consider them, I think about them, and you know, I get something out of it. It triggers, it clues me in some way. I enjoy all the likes of the videos. I know people are liking the video. And so actually, this is not just me. It's actually all the viewers and everyone that's involved with all this project, really. So again, thanks to everyone. And hopefully you can hang with it. I know this explanation is like, wow, but maybe the way I explained it, maybe it can kind of, you know, you said, yeah, I think I sort of feel this, that I sort of, the picture sort of emerging. Now, of course, it took me all this time, because to come out of where we were in the 60s and 70s, and then to get it in place right here now, where we're what we're leading into, that's not a piece of cake. That really is not. So I had a hard time with it, for sure. Very hard time. But the thing was, is that my tendencies and dying habits and stuff in the past was to work on something that was extremely difficult for a long, 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 long time without getting it. So I had this incredible patience to work super hard on something without getting results. And so that's what I did. I didn't get results, but I didn't give up. I said, you know, I know I can get it. It's just really tough. Now I can see why. Because it's too cool, you know. God is too great, it's so humorous. We just couldn't imagine that He really has this remedy for us. We thought we had to spend some time on it, but we need to spend time to realize we don't need to spend any time on it. That takes a while. See what I'm saying? It's a paradox. To resolve this paradox, it seems like we got to use a lot of time and effort to realize we don't need to use any time and effort. Because we still don't trust God, you see. But the more we trust God, the more we start to realize, hey, maybe I don't need to use any time and effort. Maybe the Holy Spirit has the answer for me right now. So it takes a while to build this trust. That's all I'm saying. People ask me, well, how come you need time to realize you need time? Trust. Trust takes time. And it's something you have to work on. And I kept working. Can I really trust God? Really trust the Holy Spirit? Really trust? So it is a question of trust. So I wake up in the morning and say, Holy Spirit, how can you help me trust you more? You know, that should be the prayer. How can I learn to trust you more? And then the Holy Spirit will help you out every day in that endeavor. And we really need to trust right now, because of this intensive coming up, this intensive of how to learn to love, appreciate, and value death. You might call it that. It's just an intensive. Let's say like it's a 4-year intensive coming up. Let's look at it that way. There's this 4-year intensive coming up. And everybody's signed up, you know, signed up. And they'll say, there'll be some great teachers there. Death-philic teachers. They're very death-philic teachers. You know, they've gained great insight on how to love, appreciate, and value death. They're very advanced teachers, you know. We're bringing in the heavyweights. We're even bringing them from other planets. How about that? Visiting teacher emeritus, professor emeritus from Orion is here. And oh, thank you. Welcome, sensei. Welcome, teacher. We're so delighted to have you here. Yeah, advanced teachers from all over the galaxy are coming to the planet, sharing their knowledge about how to learn to love, appreciate, and value death. And they're all here. So everybody's sign up. You know, it's like Obamacare on steroids. They say you got to be signed up April 15th. Everybody's got to be signed up by then to take this intensive. Otherwise, you're gonna miss it. If you miss it, you're gonna be very sorry. You know. So we're all thinking, we're like, oh my God, I haven't signed up yet. I haven't signed up yet. Oh, see, we're nervous, thinking I didn't sign up. I'm gonna miss it. Oh my God. The last second, everybody's gonna say, okay, I gotta sign up. No, you don't have to sign up. I'm not gonna sign up, because I know the answer. So you don't have to sign up either. Be assured, you don't have to sign up for this intensive. Not at all. Not at all. Those heavyweight teachers, they're just jokesters. They're just pranksters, actually. Heavyweight pranksters. But the real prankster is the Holy Spirit that pranks the pranksters. Okay, so we have the real prankster in our corner. We have the Holy Spirit. We have the true, cool, the real cool prankster of God in our corner, you see. And so we don't have to, we're not going to be shortchanged on what's totally cool, believe me. Okay, very great. This is the opposite of solar eclipse. The light is hitting me right now like that. Alrighty. Thanks for watching. And what happens next? I don't know. Just let this percolate. Just let the take it in. It's a lot to take in, but give it a try. And don't sign up for that Blood Moon Intensive. I don't need it.